So, maybe you can start in your own words a little bit about the path you've taken in your career and how you got to where you are now with Waukesha Metals.
I guess the journey really starts once I graduated high school. I really didn't know what I wanted to do. I was accepted to lacrosse. I really wanted to be a basketball player, as I tell my son all the time. So I wanted to be a walk-on, but it didn't feel right. I was not a very good student. I really didn't like school that much. So my second option was to get into the Air Force. I took all the tests. I went through everything they needed to do, but they wouldn't give me a physical because I had asthmatic bronchitis when I was 12 years old. So they rejected me right from the beginning. So the other thing that I really loved was draw. I wanted to be an architect, but I was able to go to a school. It was called Acme Institute of Technology. A lot of people laugh when I say that, the AIT, but it was a technical school for tool and die design. And that really set the course for my entire career. Tool and die design, nobody even knew what that was. A lot of my friends went off to college. Even my girlfriend at the time, digitally, went off to college. Good story, she's here, by the way. Thank you for coming. And actually, before I get into that, I really should thank everybody today. I had a fantastic day meeting with the faculty, meeting with the students, taking a tour of the facility. Everyone has been absolutely so kind to me, so I do appreciate that, and thank you very much. I don't know if I've talked this much ever, but anyways, back to the story. So as I started in the tool and die area, I was able to, very quickly, within a year of going to school, I got a job for a small manufacturer. And once I finished, I was hired full time. And one of the things that happened is, maybe not even a year, 6 months to a year into my job, my boss left. And he was actually, we got along very well, we collaborated very well, he was kind of my mentor, and he got up and left. And so I didn't know what was going to happen. Well, the vice president came up to me and said, you know, well, we're not going to hire anybody else. You're going to do it. So I, early 20s, I don't even know how old I was. So I was kind of thrown into a management role, working with the engineering department, working with the tool and die side of it, working with manufacturing. So I was kind of thrown into that. I was very green. I was fairly shy and somewhat introverted, I will say that, but I really was. And it really forced me to work with people. It really forced me to grow rather quickly. And I'm thankful for that today because it really set the path for me for my journey. I took on a couple of other jobs. I was able to work and go to school at the same time, so we saved a little bit of money. 1989, we were able to get married, so we got married and continued to work. And I started to evolve in my career, started getting into management. And it was really important to me at that point to really take management courses. I kind of failed going to MSOE on a few courses, MATC, because I couldn't make the class. I'd have to drop them. I'd try to go, I'd have to drop them, and it just wasn't working out. But as I started to evolve in management and started to get into budgeting and planning and forecasting and HR challenges, I knew I needed to get some additional education. So Cardinal Switch was perfect for me. Came here, I was able to apply a lot of what I learned here right into what I was doing on a day-to-day basis, which was fantastic. So ultimately, went and worked for a few other manufacturers in the neighborhood, and ultimately ended up at Waukesha Metal Products. And the intent when we went to Waukesha Metal Products, my partner and I and the management team, it was always our goal to purchase the company. So in 2005, we did that. And so since 2005, we've grown the organization to what it is today. We were double-digit growth for many years. The accolades are great, but it's really the people that work for us. We were able to purchase a couple of other companies during this time. And so today we are a global organization with a manufacturing facility in Sussex, a manufacturing facility in Grafton, and then we just opened up almost a year ago a Mexico facility in San Luis Obispo.
We're going to come back more to talk about the business. One thing you weaved in there and that I wanted to ask early, in terms of you got 3 degrees here at Switch, and you taught some, when we talked before about from that very first class, you had to do a lot of writing and presenting, to the role of the very last class when you had your final capstone. Could you talk, maybe hit on those two and in other ways Switch has played, your education has played a role?
Well, like I was some students to that. I said, after the first course, I wanted to quit. I hated writing. I still don't like to write that much today, as my wife would attest to. And we had to give a speech. So I had to write a paper or give a speech every class. And I struggled through it. I absolutely hated it. But the teacher, I forgot his name, everybody, but he was wonderful. He forced me through it. I had great support at home. I had great support with the group that I was with. So I made it through that class. And so that after I made that class, I figured I could do anything. And so going through the associate program, going through the bachelor's program, and even the master's program, like I said, I was able to apply a lot of what I was doing in the class, whether it be strategic planning, forecasting, modeling, statistics, whatever it was, I was able to take that to work and utilize it almost right away. And Karen, who was one of my group members, we were able to do a lot of the stuff between with manufacturing that I could apply to it. So, thanks for coming, by the way. And so for me, it was fantastic. So once we started developing the business plan for Waukesha Metal Products, it was Waukesha Community Stamping at the time, actually did my capstone and wrote a majority of the business plan for Waukesha Metal. So I was able to take the capstone and translate that into the operating agreement that we had to present to the bank and our equity fund to start the business, start to take the business over.
And so from there, and I know one of the themes we often talk about, and really the theme of this of these sessions, part is how do your own values play a role in that day-to-day business, whether you solidified it here at Stridge or things, your core values that you grew up with, how do you see that playing a role in the business that you're running today and the way you approach it?
I think, you know, the values that I had growing up, the values that I have today, it's just instilled in everything that you do. Like I was telling the people earlier today, the way I am here is the way I work at business, or the way I'm at work. I try to have fun, you try to enjoy what you're doing, you want to be enthusiastic, optimistic, you want to bring people up and motivate them through their work day. But just, you know, honesty and integrity, those are really the two things that drive, really our business is really what drives me.
And so from there, in terms of what, that's part of what drives you, so maybe speak a little bit about what drives you crazy in running a business. What is it that's keeping you up at night? What do you see as your business continues to grow, some of the biggest challenges?
Well, there's financial challenges, operational challenges, HR challenges, personnel challenges. There's always customer complaints or problems. There's a lot of stuff to keep you up at night. And then throw a couple kids' things in there too, you know, some decisions that they make you might not agree with. But just, you know, expenses, operating, capital, the things that we need to do to grow the business, getting people, constraints that we have. We have open space constraints at our Sussex facility. We have space constraints down in Mexico, not to a degree that we're confined, but the fact that we're filling up with equipment. We're still working on getting the business part of it. You know, the challenges of you're dealing with the banks, you're dealing with all the things that are part of the business, so you're always thinking about something. What can you do better? Where can we drop or cut some expenses? How can we become more profitable?
So, and I know part of one of the biggest challenges of the last few years has been opening up in Mexico.
Yeah, the last year has been a challenge. We actually tried to start a Mexico facility back in 2007, 2008. We would have started on the border, but everybody knows what happened in 2008. The economy really took a dump. Things got bad for everybody, so we refrained from doing that. And it actually worked out because now, later down the road, closer to our customer base. We were able to buy a company that already had equipment, already had people, which to me was going to be the biggest challenge. Opening up a greenfield organization down in, you know, we didn't know the culture very well, we didn't know the business side of it. So just trying to hire people that would be able to manage it and operate it would have been extremely difficult. So by buying an existing business with already having personnel there, it was great. Now it's just a matter of growing the business. Right now, the last year has been customer visits. It's been customer audits. In the automotive sector, you've got to be TS or ISO certified. You have to have an ISO 14000 certification for environmental. You need to have an AS9100 certification if you're going to do anything with aerospace. So we've been working diligently over the last year to get all of those certifications so that we can actually get some business. There are a lot of companies out there that if you don't have those, you're not going to get any business. So that's really been the challenge. It's also been fun to be great.
In terms of challenges, HRO comes to mind, and you talked about that a little bit. In terms of when you're looking to hire somebody, mm-hmm. and what you're looking for a candidate, you're growing in different ways. So along with the Stritch degree, what else do you look for?
When you're hired.
Only the Stritch degree. in our business, it's a little bit different. Even having conversations today, throughout the day, we make things, we build things, and there's a lot of, even in our class, there were a lot of service industries where banking, finance, IT, things of that nature, or even PepsiCo, I think, was where we were at. So we did the beverage companies. So we were very diverse, but I was really one of the only manufacturers. And so really, a lot of the positions that we're looking for, in some cases, it's finding people on the floor who have a technical degree, tool and die makers. But when we are looking for accountants or HR side of it, engineers, program engineers, what we're looking for when people come to us, we want some professional people that are going to represent the company very well that have a great technical background.
You also talked about working on teams. That's been sort of a theme in our conversations today. And some people into the team projects, they have the classes, some hate them with passion. In terms of where you see that playing in reality as you're going through.
I love working with teams. That was the best part of it. I know that some people hate, they want to be focused and only do their part of the project or whatever it may be, but the reality of it is, in the business world, you work with teams. You have to collaborate. You're talking with different facets of the organization, different functional areas. You're putting a group together to put a marketing campaign together. You're working as a group on a new project. So, to me, I love working with teams. I love to collaborate. That was one of the funnest. I thought that was the best part, actually, of going to school here, because you learn from the people around you. And they actually strengthened me. I became a little bit better writer. I was able to, I didn't mind. I would rather do a presentation than write a paper. No matter what it was on. I would rather have done that just so I didn't have to write. But, the team also, you have your ups, your downs. You have the times that, you have things, let's face it, we work full time, we're raising families, we're doing different things in different parts of different classes maybe you weren't that strong in, and you really need to be lifted up because you're, in struggle. So you go through these ups and downs, and by working as a team and understanding what everybody's strengths were and their weaknesses, you could work together to put a good project and again, learn from each other. That, to me, that was the most valuable part of it.
One of the things you said, it would be interesting just to get a feel of the room. Where people are employed now, how many would say they're in the finance area? Let's put finance and banking. And how many people have some sort of HR role or in the HR realm? About marketing? About how many people here are in manufacturing?
Oh, really?
All right. So one of the things, if you could switch back. So the thing that I found that I got most excited about today is talking about the stuff they make. Real stuff, and so this is our segue. So your questions will come soon, but maybe if we just come down, and you could just describe a couple of the things that you make. I'm going to grab a couple for you.
Yeah, what I did today is, it's always hard for us guys who make things to show pictures to actually understand what they are. We do a lot. Well, 53% of our business is for automotive. And then we also do consumer products, we do medical. So I brought in a couple of things to show the kids today. This is a device that we produce. We actually make the stainless steel covers. And what it is it's used in the dental industry. and they put all their instruments in here at the end of the day or when they're done to have it sanitized. This right here is in kind of everything we do, we don't get a lot of credit for because it's underneath the hood of a car or it's behind a speaker or it's underneath or covered with plastic. This right here is actually a part that we make. It's an aluminum. I had to bend it up a little bit. But we make this for a number of automotive companies. And what this is this actually goes, we ship this to Honduras. And what they do is they put that fake woodworking on it, and then they put the very high glossy acrylic on it. But what this is, it's an aluminum piece that we send to Honduras. Honduras actually does that process. It gets formed, and this is actually goes on a Mercedes-Benz, and this is where you open the door. So when you open the door, this is what's coming in, this is going out, and this is that piece. And then we also make other pieces that go throughout the cars and some of the trucks where you just have that kind of lacquer finish. So that's kind of the stuff that we do. I think we're on every major automotive company out there, whether we're making just a small bracket or it's a bracket to hold some of the electrical work underneath. We make a lot of components that actually you put the sensors for, blind spot sensors, things like that. We'll actually make the boxes that all the electronics go into it, and we'll detect as it goes through. So that's the kind of stuff that we do. We also make products, some of the stuff here we make, the big part on the left is for Subaru. It's actually a woofer bracket, the woofer seat goes inside of that. We actually do some cabinets over in our fabrication facility. We do box drops, or actually book drops for some of the libraries. They actually still use those sometimes. And so I think they're, I don't have another one here. And so we also do stuff for the part up in the right-hand side. That actually goes over the caliper and braking system of the Ford F-250s. And then the part that's on the top actually goes into a woofer for a Bose Entertainment Center. The entertainment center that's advertised during football games, that's a part that actually goes into that whole assembly system. So that's kind of what we do, and it's interesting. I actually brought this in because I wanted to show the kids. You know, my kids barely know this, but I used to work for a company, and just to kind of show them, we were talking about supply and demand and the microeconomics course, and we were talking just about how quickly things evolve. Well, inside of this cassette, there's a stainless steel part that actually holds the two reels down. A company that I worked for had a patent on that, and we produced every part for VHS cassette around the world back in the late 80s, early 90s. We made 30 million of them a week, and then we also did, so we were supplying Kodak, JVC, and all of that, but we know it took over the CD. And now, the CD's being taken over by what? Stream it in. So we just talked about how quickly things move. But again, it's kind of funny because when I go to a store or things that we produce, we used to make a lot of flame guards for pots and pans. And the flame guard was the little component between the handle and the pan. There's a little stainless steel aluminum. We used to make all those, and I used to design all that stuff. So my wife would always yell at me because I'd be in the store up and, you know, kind of taking a look at it. Or when you walk through a Menards or a Home Depot, that's a manufacturer's dream. You walk through there to see how things are made. You've got lawnmowers, you've got the agricultural side, you've got snow blowers. So you take a look at that. How's it manufactured? That's the kind of stuff that we do. And so it was just kind of neat just to talk about how quickly these things come and go. We're making 30 million a week, shipping them worldwide, and within about 4 or 5 years, nothing. And so it's amazing how quickly things change. And that's really one of the philosophies that we have at our organization, is that, you know what, you need to be flexible, you need to be adaptive, and you need to be responsive. So you have to be able to do it quickly. If you don't, you're not going to survive. And so those are some of the things that we kind of preach, and we really take it to heart. It's really part of our business model. So we make stuff. That's what we do, and we are proud of it. It's kind of funny too, because I had two of my boys actually work for us. My oldest, who's off in college, but he works for us in the summertime. My middle son works with us as an apprenticeship. But we were at my son's college, and they were putting up a speaker system in their new field house. And he came running to us and said, "Hey, Dad, I think we made this, because we make a lot of the stuff for the Bose speakers, especially for large auditoriums." So those big speaker systems that you see that come down, all the bracketry we make. We
didn't happen to make this one, but he thought we did. He was actually kind of proud. I thought, that's right. Making stuff is good.
So, on that note, just want to open it up. Mike talked about a lot of different pieces, and I'd contribute if you could get the mic, if people have questions. That gentleman in the back there clearly is ready. So, lots of topics, so I think I was open to any pieces of it, so ask away.
Hi, Michael. My name is Elazar. I'm in the MBA program, and my question, it's two parts, but the one that I'm more interested in is, when you make products, are you solving problems? Are you looking to make something to solve a problem? Or, my question is, how do you go about it? Or do your customers come to you and say, hey, we need something that does this? Yeah. How do you go about choosing and figuring out what products you make for who?
We're a contract manufacturer, so we build based on a customer specification. So they design the car, they have all these products, they send them out to hundreds of us probably throughout the world actually. So we'll take a look at a part, like the part up at the top, and what we'll do is if it fits within our capability and our capacity within the organization, we'll quote to produce that. We design the tool, we actually manufacture and build it in-house, and we maintain that tool for the customer and provide them product. So they give us the part print, and we take that part print and we make it reality. It's really what happens. Do we solve problems? Yeah, we solve problems all the time, daily. Just anybody who's dealt with the automotive industry, you know, what was that?
Saving jobs.
Yeah, there's a couple of things. So that's my wife, Renee Lutton. Actually, you know what, I give her a tremendous amount of support. If she, you know, when you go through this, and anybody who's in night school, who's ever gone through night, to have the support of your family is critical because of all the time that you're spending away, spending in the library, spending at school. So I have to give her some kudos. And hey, Tony, one of my friends just showed up too. Great. Actually, there's a couple of things here. The very top piece, that actually came to us in two pieces. So we went to the customer, and there was another slide that I showed the students this morning that showed how we go through and do an analysis on how a part can be produced, whether it's going to break, whether it's going to crack in its form. So that used to be two pieces, and what we did is we went to the customer and said, hey, we can make this out of one. So we can save you some money, we can produce it, we don't need to do the second to the dairy assembly to put this together. So we just said it's going to be a little ugly in the transition, but if you can accept that, we can do it. They accepted it and off we went. So that was part of some of the, you know, kind of the proactive approach to it. The problem solving for us comes when there's a problem or an issue. How are we going to address it? What are we going to do? You know, we have anybody manufacturers or a bunch of hands, so if I say AD and corrective actions and preventive actions, you know exactly what I'm talking about. There's a problem, how you're going to correct it so it doesn't happen again. How are you going to prevent it from happening? We do that all the time.
What other questions do you have right here?
Yes, you mentioned that.
We could wait for the mic for a moment. Thanks.
You mentioned that you went from that the DVD or the VCR selling 30 million per day or week to nothing. How do you compensate for that? How did your degree with or your studies at Carter Stretch help you with that?
That particular company that I was with was bought out by a leveraged buyout company, and I got out. And what happened is it actually, it was just a different management style and something that I really didn't agree with. So I moved on, and actually 2 years later, they couldn't compensate for it. They went out of business. Actually, it was probably longer than it. They may have been able to hold on for longer. But they bought that business at a height. This was at its prime, so they got it. So it was sold, and they just couldn't make up for it on the back end. So it was a huge part of the business, and they just weren't able to make it up.
On the side,
I can talk loud. To what extent is the tool and die industry being forced evolutionary lines by new technology like 3D printing, so on and so forth? I'm always interested in how communications between the customer and the supplier is impacted. My background printing industry, and one of the things that is directly impacted was prepress, all the things that are done before information is sent to the printer to print. The back end, the printing side, is basically execution. So what you're dealing with is, on the customer side, an evolving skill set, computer-based and communications-based, that needs to be seamlessly woven into what you do here. So tell me about communications and the things you learned at Stritch that enhance your ability to communicate.
Well, with the tool and die, and actually just technology altogether, designing dies, when I started designing dies, it was on a board. The CAD systems came out. We barely even look at a print anymore. We don't even have a lot of paper on our manufacturing floor. Everything is downloaded in models. It comes over to us, it goes into the computer system. Our designers can actually put it into a tool and simulate how that part is going to be produced or the die. We actually incorporate sensoring systems. Everything we do is sensored. We run very lean across our manufacturing facility, so we have one person that's running 2 to 3 presses. And as soon as something happens, it has to turn off instantly. So we take a model. We barely even take a drawing anymore. Before we had to take a drawing, lay it out, do all that stuff. Now we just take a model from the customer, we implement that into the design, everything comes around it. We can do simulation. Like we were talking up here, we can do a simulation to see whether the material is going to crack, whether it's going to bend, whether it's going to be able to be used long term in the field. And so all of technology just has evolved. 3D printing is hot in many areas right now, because you can actually produce a part and put it together and see how it's going to work. We use 3D printing because we get models, and sometimes we don't even get drawings. We actually take that model and have a 3D print made out of it, so we can actually touch and feel the part itself. So, as far as the technical side of it, Stritch really didn't do anything for me on a technical side, because that was really what we do. But to understand, to evolve, to look at the different technologies out there that are going to help your efficiencies, that are going to have increase the throughput, all of that definitely is part of the education, and really part of the research and development that you do on any given job that you have. Technology is huge. If you walk through our facility, you don't see drawings. A lot of people will have drawings of parts and things scattered out at benches. Everything is computerized. Everything we do is sent out by a computer. There are computers by our presses. Literally, the minute that they put their material up to the press and start running it, the accounting side of it takes it from a raw material to a work in process or finished goods, whatever it may be. It automatically takes that out of the system. It automatically runs all the accounting side of it, pulls it out. When we go to invoice, we automatically invoice. It's amazing where technology has taken a lot of people and a small company like us to be able to do that. And our system is internet-based, so no matter where you are in the world, you can see. I actually can see the presses running from my computer screen. Or if they're not running, I can type in what's the matter or what's going on. So the technology's evolved. It's amazing how far it's gone and how quickly, and what it does for us from just a productivity and efficiency side.
The reason I'm asking this is that my experience had been, it's not producing the product, which is a skill set. It's not designing the product, which is a skill set. It's not marketing or selling the product, which is a skill set. The problem is connecting and communicating between the silos. And so I always have a concern in manufacturing that the way you evaluate is not looking at the processes that you do to produce the product, but the communication links that allow you to do it seamlessly.
No, yeah, that's all done through our systems internally.
So your IT people are like real important.
Yep. Say that again.
Your IT people are like real important.
Yeah, absolutely. When it goes down, it goes down. Especially being internet-based, when if the internet goes down, so that now the whole risk management side of it comes in, so that if it does go down, what's your backup and all that? Well, yeah, when the internet goes down, we're down. And it's happened a couple of times, and you just sit and say, okay, this only can be down for 5 minutes. We need to get going. If it's down for more than that, we have some problems.
Other questions? Bring over the mic.
just would like to know, how did you maintain such a positive mindset throughout your whole journey?
I don't know. I think I've always been like this. I don't know if I've been any different. Ask my family. They think I'm crazy. My little man Drew back here. I told him I was going to embarrass him when he came here. But you know what? I work with people who, you know, you work with pessimists. You work with people who they can bring the whole shop down. They can bring, you know. So I think you have to have a good attitude. You got to enjoy what you're doing. I enjoy what I'm doing, even though there are tough days or there are decisions that you have to make that aren't the easiest. There are things that you go through that certainly, you know, try you as an individual, but. For the most part, you know what, I enjoy getting up in the morning and breathing. And that's a good start. Plus the fact, I think, you know what, and we talked a little bit about this earlier too, is that I truly do believe in the mind, body, and soul. You have to work out. You've got to, you know, you need to try to take care of yourself as much as you can. It is a stressful business. I'm not going to lie to you. Anybody who is a manufacturer is very quick. You need to really respond to your customers' needs, and you have to do it very quickly. And it can become trying, there's no doubt. But, you know what, I just think you need to be positive, you need to take care of yourself, and you know what, good things will come. That's the least what I try to tell my children.
Hey, Mike, I'm not going to try to stop.
All right.
First thing I'm going to say is thank you for reminding us that manufacturing and making stuff is cool. Sometimes we lose sight of that, and I think sometimes manufacturing isn't always looked at as a kind of a cool place to go for work. And so thank you for reminding us that that this can be cool and it can be everywhere we look. Manufacturing plays a role in that. I have the fortune of working with underserved populations and underskilled workforces and job training programs, getting people prepared, getting them job ready. What can we do to help underskilled populations become ready and equipped to work in the manufacturing industry?
You know, one of the things that, and I actually think, Tony, you and I have talked about some of this stuff before, is we need people to come to work. Then as you gain the skills and just the math and the soft skills and all the stuff that I know you're trying to get your people to develop, it comes down sometimes to transportation. It comes down to how do you give these guys or gals an opportunity to work, but they have to get to work. So there's always that logistics part of it that's always been a challenge. It's a challenge for us. We're out in Waukesha and Grafton. There's no bus system. There's nothing that comes out because we can certainly, you know, we've talked, we can't find people. We can't find people to work out onto our manufacturing floor. And you're right, the manufacturing has taken kind of a black eye over the years. It's not a good place to work. It's not, you know, it's dirty, it's dungy. No, it's highly technical. It's, do you get your hands dirty by setting up and running product? Absolutely, but you're doing something for a living. It actually pays very well. So to get those soft skills, to do the math, to be able to read and to write and to communicate, those are all the things that they have to do. The problem is how do we get manufacturers to get those employees to them, or how can we get the transportation system to get it out? And it's difficult. I mean, we're out in Waukesha, there's nothing there. And that's really the difficult part of it. And I know we have a number of people who carpool. And we have a number of people who actually are from the Milwaukee area that come in. So we've all often said, hey, if you can find somebody that you can buddy up with to get a ride in, and they pay a little small, you know, fee for gas, that's great. But that's our challenge. That's a big challenge. It's a challenge for you, and I know it's a challenge for us. And obviously, if people are willing to work, we want them to work. Did that answer your question?
It did. You know, one of the biggest strategies and probably one of the biggest opportunities for lobbying is around driver's license recovery programs, helping people who have lost a license or people who never got their license get those licenses so they can get out to the best for areas. Anything we can do around transportation?
Because that's what we found has been the biggest issue. Because we're willing to train. We're willing to bring people on and train them. We put people through school. We you know, provide them a actually you get a pretty good wage. You know, there is no minimum wage where we are because it really comes down to that supply and demand that we were talking about earlier. You know what? We have the demand for work, but the supply is not there. So you're going to earn a better.
consider taking your company to another level as far as building a new company in the inner city so you can employ more individuals? I am a representative of the Martin neighborhood, and we had a meeting last night, and this man that works for the city of Milwaukee, his name is Mr. Mandez, and they're going to do a Century City industrial technology zone, and I have the schematics right here, and I was wondering if you would employ some people in the inner city to get a job.
It would be great, but here's our problem. We have a highly capitalized facility. Good try. Absolutely. So we have a very, when you walk through our facilities, we have presses, 600 ton presses that are, they go up and they're in pits. Hundreds of thousands of dollars to pick those machines up. Hundreds of thousands of dollars. When we started fortunately for us, we started the plant even in Connexion. Presses were there. So for a manufacturing company, for us just to pick up and go and to move it, you can't. I mean, no, we're a little guy. So we can talk to the phone. It's a lot of room, and you know what? I'm with you, but it's not easy for us. And it's just something that we can't do. And we were established since 1971 in Waukesha. But they need to get some business done in Milwaukee. You need to employ. You know, everything that you read about and the unemployment level, absolutely. You're welcome. I probably didn't answer your question, but that's... I can't make any promises.
So thanks for asking. So we have a question over here.
Yeah. Is your only... interviewing Stritch graduates, and those are the only applicants that you're only taking Stritch applicants, they're the best, they're the finest, mm-hmm. they're the only ones that have. As I look around this room, and I'm in manufacturing, you're in manufacturing, and I see a lot of people under the age of 35. Mm-hmm. How do you look at those people? What courses, what specific areas of education do you look for in manufacturing that you would say to these students under age 35, you are the next generation, take these courses, develop your skills in those courses? And then what would you say to Stritch management to say to them, I've been through the program worked for me, we've got another generation coming behind, you need to offer these skill sets, courses for manufacturing management.
Wow, okay. I didn't think I was gonna get tough questions. Actually, you know, as we were walking through and spending time with faculty, which was great, because you're right, when I went through the program, it really applied to everything that I was doing. I was actually in a position where I could take what I was learning at school and apply it where I was working. So I was in a position that I thought if this would really work, I could implement it. A lot of people don't have that opportunity or that ability to do that. And when we bring people through our organization, because when you walk through your manufacturing, so you have the HR side of it, you've got the accounting and financial side of it, you've got the marketing side of it, you've got the whole manufacturing side of it, of how to do it. And for me, getting the overall, you know, getting a good balance of that was important to me. Because once you start getting to management, who do you work
with? I'm self-employed.
You're self-employed. What kind of manufacturing?
I sell capital equipment. I sell
sorts of
capital equipment.
Okay. So as you go through, and we take a lot of, we give people a lot of tours, and we take kids through tours too, because a lot of people don't know what manufacturing is. It's interesting when you talk to the kids and say, yeah, the chair, you sit down, that was manufacturing. Nobody thinks about that except manufacturing. So to me, you really want to be well-rounded. So when we bring people through, we show them what we do in the HR, we show them what we do in finance, we show them what we do in marketing. And again, we are a small company, so we don't have these huge areas and a lot of people working there. But it's really kind of, what do you want to do in life? You know, the 35-year-olds and younger that are here, you know, sometimes I still think, what do I want to do when I grow up? But I think
you're always going to deal with finance, right? You're always going to deal with people. You're always going to deal with working together as groups. So you really want to have those courses that talk about that, or actually are teaching that different concept. Business law was, you know, I didn't think I really wanted that class or didn't like it. It was a fun class. I never thought I would apply. I apply it all the time. It's amazing. I mean, everything you deal with is you're dealing with the law in some sort of way. So to me, what the Stritch program did is it gave me a well-rounded education to apply into a lot of functional areas. But again, I was very fortunate because I was working with all these functional areas. And talking to some people today, you know, you're working in one area doing one thing, it's kind of functional, and you really can't get the information that you need in some of these courses to help yourself. But what I also told them, said, you know, what you're doing today, you may not be doing tomorrow. You may not be doing a year from now. And a class that you don't think is really important today may be very important for you, you know, 6 months down the road. I think the courses that we took, we really applied to what we were doing. And it sounds like now that whole technology with online and things that they're doing to help students out now to be able to get their degrees, I think all that's great. This was the challenge we were talking about today, is how do you have one thing that fits all? You know, we were talking about our training. We do training programs that work. Well, training one person one way, they get it. Training a whole group, two or three, may not. So you're trying to train everybody under one training program, but not everybody gets it. So my experience has been, I got a well-rounded education. I think that's what everybody should get. To say specifically what you need to do and what you need to change, you know, I'm not the academia side of it, so I can't tell them what to do. But I think we had shared a lot of, you know, a lot of things that I thought worked for me personally, and I think the feedback that at least I got from a lot of the teachers is, yeah, you know, most of the feedback is positive, but you always have the one or two or the three that it's difficult to do everything for one thing that's going to apply to everything. But I think it's a well-rounded, I think the whole management side of it, I thought was pretty well-rounded. Gave me a lot of the skill sets that I needed in different functional areas of the company. So I don't know if I answered your question or not.
So we have time for one more question. I want to make a student, so over there.
Great. Yes, my name is Durell, and I'm in the Masters of Science and Management program. I kind of wanted to piggyback off the young lady over there that offered a proposal for you to kind of help benefit the inner city populations and perhaps created a plan. May not have been the most cost-effective proposal, but I wanted to suggest perhaps you can do something as far as logistics is concerned and as far as transportation is concerned. I know that we have a temporary agency that provides transportation from the temporary agency in Milwaukee to Sussex, where the actual plant is. I was wondering if you were interested in doing something like that.
Absolutely. We've actually looked into it. We're in an industrial park, and we were actually talking with other businesses in the industrial park to see what we could do to try to get people out. You know, again, those who are willing to work don't have the transportation to get there. We were actually trying to work on a program to get them out there. Then all of a sudden the economy went down again, and that kind of talk went away. But we've been talking about that a little bit more. What can we do? Because we are struggling to get people, and we're really struggling to get people on some of our off shifts. We run 7 days a week. We're on Monday through Thursday, two shifts, and then we run Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, which we think is, those who do it love it, because, you know, child care comes into play. If somebody works the weekend shift, they don't have to have child care Monday through Thursday. But the transportation has been an issue for us, and it's something that we've been looking at, and we're going to continue to look at, because there's going to be a point in time where we're really going to need to get people. And I think a lot of manufacturers, and those out here that you can tell me, I think we're all in the same boat. Sometimes it's just difficult to get people out to work. But no, both points are well received, and I think it's just a matter of really working through to see how it can be cost effective. Always comes down to business.
Thank you, Sirius. Thank you, Michael, most of all, for kicking it off, for staying engaged
with us here at Stritch. And as you can see, you're starting for the next 4 months. It's a different night of week. So those of you who attend class on Wednesday night, you won't have it during class again for the next 4 months, but please feel free to, if you see someone of interest to you, to join us at another session. So thank you very much, Michael, for spending the day with us, for talking about the company, connecting at the Stritch, and just being part of the